Good morning, and welcome to Leacock Presbyterian Church as we gather together to worship our Lord. This is the time for the announcements, and I'm going to go right cut to the chase. This Sunday, we are again having a remote communion. So if you don't have the bread and juice ready, pause this service and go and get them, because we will be doing that later in the service. Again, I'm going to request any prayer requests that you have, joys or concerns that you want to share with the congregation. Again, I have been receiving some, and that is very helpful. It helps all of us to know where the joys and concerns are in our lives together. If you know of anybody in need, please let either the secretary or me know, and we will do what we can to help them. Again, I would urge you to support the factory, which is doing a wonderful work for the people in this community. Any non-perishables or money are greatly appreciated. Finally, next week, 4th of July weekend, we will be regathering at Old Leacock at 8 and here in Paradise at 9:30. By now, I hope all of you have received the letter that I sent out to the congregation, and then on Monday or Tuesday, you will be receiving the newsletter, which has even more information about regathering. As we mentioned in all of our various communications, this is a trial. We're trying to learn from this how best to be together in one place in a safe way. But this much I can say, it will not work without your help. So please help the ushers, help Diane and me as we try to give a worship service in place that will work and keep people safe. It's going to be different. But I know how many of you want us to gather again together. And for those who can't, for those who shouldn't, we are still going to be recording the service, and you'll still be able to watch it at home, if that's what you choose, and if that's what you think is the safest. So that concludes our announcements. Let us begin our worship together. Worship God. Let us pray. God of grace, we welcome you now into our hearts, into our lives. Teach us what it means to live a life of welcome for friend, for stranger. All this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We're now going to sing hymn 472, which is such a well-known hymn, Kumbaya, that it's actually become sort of an in-joke for many people. When things are being addressed too simplistically, people will say, well, let's just all sing Kumbaya. But you know, when you listen to these words, they're very simple words. Someone's crying, someone's singing, someone's praying. Kumbaya, which means, come by here, Lord. We need the Lord to come by here. Of us that have been wrong and what we've done and left undone. So now let us say in our hearts, and first in silence, the thing we confess. And this week I would invite you all to consider this question. How do I not welcome? Whom do I not welcome? Let us pray. Let us pray. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, in word, in deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive who we've been, help us change what we are, and show us what we should and shall be, so that we may delight in your name and love our neighbors in deed and in word. All this we say in the name of the risen Christ. Amen. You might think, with all the wrong turns we make over the course of a life, all that is broken in each of us, that God would get tired of us, would turn away, turn us away. But the good news of our faith is that never happens. God delights to have us return, just like a prodigal son, a prodigal daughter. God is eager to feed us. God is eager to heal us. And this is why I can say to you this day, in Jesus Christ, that we are forgiven. Don't turn away from a sister or a brother. Turn towards them. Welcome them back. Amen. This week, those of you who are not on the prayer chain may not have heard that, but B. Andrew's son-in-law, Greg, fell and broke his leg into three different places and will have to be bedridden for about 8 weeks. Also, B. Andrew's brother, Dick, a horrible situation, fell and got his arm caught in a handicap bar and couldn't get it out, and so was left there stuck until his daughter came and found him, and he was dehydrated and had to be taken to the hospital. So we'd ask that you pray for Dick as well. On the joy front, our prayer family this week are the Lichtys. They are fine. Everybody seems to be working. If you work for the Postal Service, as Matt does, you just don't stop. Michelle, of course, is doing a lot of work with people, and mostly in their homes. Leah, Sarah, Catherine, and me, and all as well are working. So they're coping with this COVID-19 pandemic, but in general, they are doing well. My Aunt Jan had her second eye surgery this week, and both of them went well, and she's very pleased, and hopefully her eyesight will improve dramatically. This week marked Loretta and Kevin McClarigan's 41st anniversary, which they always say is 41 plus 7 because they dated for 7 years before they got married. And those are all the joys and the concerns that I have this day. Let us pray. Merciful God, you hear our cries, and you cry with your people. The pain and sorrow in creation is not what you intended. And so we ask for your healing, your comfort, your peace. This day we especially ask that you be with the Erickson's, with Greg and Dick, and all others whom we lift up to you now in the silence of our hearts. Loving God, just as you grieve with us, so do you rejoice with us. You delight in our delight, and you bless us in so many ways. We thank you for so much, in particular today, for the Lichtys, for my aunt's successful surgeries, for Loretta and Kevin's anniversary, and for all else that we lift up to you now in the silence of our hearts. And now hear us as we pray the prayer Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our next hymn is hymn 301, which has the title, Let Us Build a House. But it is also known as All Are Welcome. And I'm not going to read all the lyrics, which are there on the website for you to look at, but I just wanted to read this one verse. Let us build a house where hands will reach beyond the wood and stone to heal and strengthen, serve and teach, and live the word they've known. Here the outcast and the stranger bear the image of God's face. Let us bring an end to fear and danger. All are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place.
Thank you.
Our scripture reading today is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, the 10th chapter, verses 40 through 42. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Two weeks ago, we read other verses from Matthew 10, in which Jesus warned, as he does in several places, about the cost of discipleship, about the fact that each of us, if we are to follow the way of Jesus Christ, will have to take up our own cross. And that sometimes that cross will involve being rejected, even by members of our families. But Jesus never leaves us in the darkness, surrounded by shadows. And so, in this reading today, after all those warnings, he gives hope, offers light in the promise of welcome. He says that whoever welcomes us, whoever welcomes someone who comes in the name of the Lord, welcomes him, actually welcomes God. And pause there for a minute. Think about what a wonder that is. Each of us, in some small way, in our own small way, represent the Lord to everyone we meet. But Jesus doesn't stop there. He also calls us to welcome others. He speaks of welcoming prophets. Who are prophets? Those are people who speak the hard, unwelcome words that people do not want to hear. They run against the grain. Who speak the will of God even when it runs counter to the human way. Jesus speaks of welcoming the righteous. The righteous, those who are in a right relation with God. But that can't be the end. Also in a right relationship with their neighbor. All their neighbors. Everyone. And if we welcome a prophet, we will receive a prophet's reward. We may, in our own small way, speak those uncomfortable truths that are the will of God. If we welcome the righteous, we will receive the reward of the righteous. That righteousness, that right relation will grow within us so that we will be in right relation with God and with all of our neighbors. To welcome. What does it mean to welcome? Well, it's not just friendliness. It's not just some tossed off greeting. Hi, how are you? When we don't even really expect or want an answer. Now, the kind of welcome that Jesus is speaking about involves bringing others into our lives. Into our lives. The word that is translated welcome can also be translated as receive. We are to receive others in. Not some kind of superficial thing, but we are to bring them into our lives. Earlier in chapter 10, Jesus speaks about welcoming, receiving not only those we know, not only those who are like us, but also imperfect strangers. Throughout the scriptures, from Genesis all the way through the New Testament, there is this theme of hospitality. And I was hoping that you and I, we would consider today, to whom do we offer hospitality? You know, you have somebody over for dinner. You put out clean sheets because you're going to have a guest. Well, whom are we inviting over for dinner? Who are our guests? Are they only friends and family? Those who in some way we either consciously or unconsciously expect to repay us in some way, reciprocate? Biblical hospitality involved the physical, yes. It involved offering shelter and food to others, including strangers. But it also had an emotional and spiritual component. For a moment, I'd like you to imagine you're in a strange country, a strange place. You're all alone and you know nobody. You're completely different from everybody else. Imagine how that would feel. Imagine the isolation. And imagine how much you would hunger for some kind of connection. This is the kind of hospitality that Jesus is speaking about. This is the kind of welcome or receiving that he is referring to. When we welcome and receive folks, all folks, not just those we know and like and who are like us, into our homes, into our lives. And even if it comes at a cost. When Jesus spoke these words, he knew that soon, and it did come true as we see in the letters of Paul, that those who followed Jesus would often be ostracized in their own community. They wouldn't be accepted. They were strangers in their own land. And often, to be considered a Christian or to be associated with Christians would make you an outcast. So it comes with a cost. And those who would receive even the outcast, that's what Jesus seeks. Those are the ones who truly are walking his way. I believe that there's a key in this passage, and it's the way it ends, where Jesus says that to even give a cup of cold water to little ones is so important. When Jesus refers to little ones, most scholars believe he's referring to disciples who weren't leaders, weren't great orators, who were just regular folks. But I believe that in this passage, Jesus is also referring to the least that he mentions later in Matthew, the lost, the forgotten, the lonely, the invisible. The kind of people I've been speaking about the last 2 weeks. A little girl who's knocked across a room by her grandfather because she wants to like all people, regardless of where they come from and what they look like. Or a woman who's afraid to go out in her own country because she looks different. And there's one other group of people I would consider the least. Those who are cast out, rejected in their own communities. There's a new term out there today called cancel culture. And I find that one of the most disturbing things that has happened in our society. Apparently, there are people who I would argue are so self-righteous that if they see somebody that does something that offends them, something they believe is wrong, even if what they're standing for is good, they cancel the other person. They reject them and banish them, never to be welcomed again into their lives. Basically, it can be an extreme, a one-and-done kind of thing. You make
make one mistake, you do one wrong thing, and you're done.
John Galliano was one of those people who was canceled. He is a European designer. And several years ago, he got drunk, and he was high. He was at a restaurant. He saw a couple, and he proceeded, I don't know what set him off, but he proceeded to abuse them, I kid you not, for 45 minutes. He started with the person, about the way she looked, about the way he looked, and then it just got darker. He started to go at them with anti-Semitic rants. Well, as will happen these days, somebody filmed it. And he ended up losing his job. He was actually charged with a hate crime, and he was found guilty at trial of racism. Sounds rather despicable, doesn't it? Somebody certainly worthy of being canceled. Let me give you his backstory. He was suffering from addiction. He felt enormous pressure, because this occurred in 2011, in the midst of the last financial crisis. His father and two other people with whom he was very close had died over a short period of time, and he hadn't been able to grieve for so many reasons. And now everything in his life seemed to be gone, his job, those he loved, connection. Abraham Foxman is the former head of the Anti-Defamation League. He has devoted his whole life, he's in his 80s, to fighting anti-Semitism, hate, and extremism in all of its forms. And that would be good enough. That would make him an admirable person. But he believes that there is a need for something more. The possibility of forgiveness. He once said, if you don't believe you can change people's hearts and minds, why bother? So he, over the years, began to look to help people back from the mistakes they have made. And he's looking for more than just a token apology or writing an easy check to a charity. He's looking for people who are willing to do the hard work of self-examination, of discovering their own truth that has led to their brokenness. Well, he was introduced to John Galliano. He spoke with him. He discovered that the man seemed to be sincere, so he introduced him to a rabbi with whom Galliano studied. And that shook him. Galliano visited Auschwitz. And he told Foxman that he had come every day to discover the need to speak with God. Well, Foxman worked hard for this man. He worked hard, and even though several times Galliano would apply for a job and be rejected, ultimately Foxman found him a place that would receive him. You know, what John Galliano did was wrong. I'm not going to sit there and say that 45 minutes of an anti-Semitic harangue is in any way justifiable. And what my friend's grandfather, when he knocked her across the room, was wrong. What Sarah did to Hagar was wrong. All of it was wrong. But you know, we are all broken. We all do wrong. And we all are in such need, whether we accept it, acknowledge it, or know it. And it can take so little to bring us back, to mean so much. If somebody offers us even a cup of cold water, to be canceled, to long for connection, that, in a way, is hell. Foxman gave a cup of cold water to John Galliano.
when he did, he offered a gift, a revelation of grace. Jesus calls us to have a full openness in our lives, in our being, as a way of life. That we are to be open to all others. And if we are, we will be open to God. That's the only way we can be truly open to God. And so what does this reading tell us? That Jesus Christ calls us to welcome, to receive the least, to offer them even a cup of cold water. Amen. Cups of cold water come in many forms. Sometimes on a warm day, it can be just that, a cup of cold water. But it's the little things in life that can mean so much. And we, each of us, need those cups of cold water. And here at the table of the Lord, we receive one. Friends, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. They will come from east and west and from north and south and sit at table together in the kingdom of God. According to Luke, when our risen Lord was at table with his disciples, he took the bread and blessed and broke it, and he gave it to them, and then their eyes were opened and they recognized him. We walk with the Lord every day of our lives, but we will miss the Lord if we're not careful, if we are not fed by the Lord. This is the Lord's table. Our Savior invites those who trust him to share the feast which he has prepared. Let us pray. You are holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. In Jesus, born of Mary, your word became flesh and dwelt among us full of grace and truth. He lived as one of us, knowing joy and sorrow. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, opened blind eyes, broke bread with outcasts and sinners, and gave cups of cold water, even to the least. Dying on the cross, he gave himself for the life of the world. Rising from the grave, he won for us victory over death. Seated at your right hand, he leads us to eternal life. We praise you that Christ now reigns with you in glory and will come again to make all things new. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share this feast, united in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. In your union with your church in heaven and on earth, we pray, O God, that you will fulfill your eternal purpose in us and in all the world. Keep us faithful to in your service until Christ comes in final victory. We shall feast with your saints in the joy of your eternal realm. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, our glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." You see, every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you in your life proclaim
the saving death of our risen Lord until he comes again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. This is the body of Christ broken for you. Take. Be fed. This is the blood of Christ, shed for you. Take, drink. Let us pray. God, you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. You have fed us with the bread of life and renewed us for your service. Help us who have shared Christ's body and received this cup to be his faithful disciples so that our daily living may be part of the life of your kingdom and our love be your love, reaching out into the life of the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now we have been fed, we have received a cup of cold water. Let us affirm our faith with the saying of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please, this week, in your homes and wherever you go, offer the peace of Christ to everyone you meet. And again, we thank you. We thank you for your kind and sustained giving. We have been apart for all these weeks, but the needs of the church and the needs of the world are still there. Just the other day, our air conditioning unit in the offices broke. So your giving is so appreciated, and we wanted you to know that. We're now going to sing our final hymn, which is hymn 515, I Come With Joy. And again, I just want to read you one verse. You'll have the lyrics there on the website. As Christ breaks bread and bids us share, each proud division ends. The love that made us makes us one, and strangers now are friends, and strangers now are friends. Thank you. Thank you again for joining us together in worship, and I'd like to give a special thanks to Mike Hartman, who raced back from vacation to make this service possible to be recorded, and for Diane racing back from vacation. Of course, I haven't had a vacation, but that's okay. Let us pray. Dear God, you have welcomed us to your table. You have fed us. May the bread and the cup make us strong. Strong in gentleness, strong in welcome to friend and foe, the blessed and the lost. May we offer many cups of cold water. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you this day and forevermore. Amen.